In our last presentation, we had talked about two types of enterprises, that is the innovation-driven enterprises and small and medium enterprises. We have also talked that innovation-driven enterprises are very much protective about their intellectual properties, and they also go for special types of financing, that is venture capital financing. Normally, the banks would not find them suitable for financing at the very initial stage. In this presentation, I shall be basically talking of venture capital financing and all aspects of it. Venture capitalists would finance new business, growing business, as well as troubled business. What they look for? They look for a large payout, they look for participation in major business process, and they want to handhold the promoter, and they want to bring the best of the ideas to the table. Or in other words, they are not simple financier. They will not simply give you money and wait for the return to come. No. They will be always associated with you, with your venture, with your innovation, and they will at every step try to help you or assist you or try to bring the best of the global practices based on their experiences. Now, how a venture capitalist is organized, how a venture capital is organized. Normally, a venture capital is organized as a limited liability partnership. As you know, limited liability partnership is a kind of entity which is not really a limited liability company, which is not really a limited liability company in that sense, which is not a private limited company, which is not a public limited company. It is a little different kind. It is called limited liability partnership, where the liability of the partners are limited. In normal course, in the partnership, the liability of the partners are unlimited. But in limited liability partnership, the liability of the partners are limited. And they pool management resources. Normally, it is a very small management team that work on it, and this management team comprises of high caliber employees, and they have a desire to handle the management of the proposer. I mean, the entity who is trying to get finance from them, they will try to handle them based on their past experience. You will find many of them had earlier worked in some banks or some industrial development agencies and things like that. And most of them are normally a management graduate or postgraduate in management, with, of course, lot of experience. They look at the cash flow and they look at the internal control of the proposer. Usually, a small but very effective management team is what they bring to the table. When you send a proposal to a venture capitalist, you have to give a description of the opportunity and the market size. You have to give the resume of your management team, that is, who are in your team. Normally, a singular effort will not be liked by the venture capitalists. They also look for a team of like-minded people who can bring to the table a lot of innovations. And they also would like to see whether you have made a review of the competitive landscape and what is the solution you are bringing to the table to counter the competition. And finally, of course, you have to give the financial projections of your venture in foreseeable time and a capitalization table, that means how you want to capitalize the operation. Normally, the venture capitalists would not like to put money in a company already listed. They would want to put money in an unlisted company so that after a reasonable growth, when the company is listed, they can make a killing by selling the shares which they already hold. There are four stages of venture capital financing. First is you have to make a business plan and submit to the venture capitalists. Then you have to introduce yourself and your team into an introductory conversation and meeting. There could be several rounds of meeting, or you may be approaching several venture capitalists. So you have to have several meetings with your team proposing to various venture capitalists. They also would send their team, and there will be a dialogue, and they will try to understand your business plan, your business process, your innovation, your timeline in more detail. Once they are through, they are convinced with the preliminary discussion like this, they may send another team for due diligence. In case of due diligence, there are more documentary evidence will be required, and more of proving your case will be needed. And once these three stages are over and you cross the due diligence hurdle, they will bring finance for you. They will be trying to fund a part of your requirement. Again, funding can be in various stages. It need not be funded all at a time. There can be various stages of funding. Now, what are the various stages of funding? The first stage of funding could be seed capital. That means a very nominal amount. They will give a very small amount so that you can use it as a capital and you can create a kind of prototype for your proposed business. They don't want you to go to market immediately or try it out, but they want you to see, they want you to show rather, what would be the prototype of your business. In a small scale, you can try to convince them that this will be the prototype of my business. Then they can give you the startup capital. Then they can give you the early stage capital. And before this third stage, or at this third stage, that is early stage capital, you have to prove your mettle. That means you have to prove that your business is going to be a resounding success. Once in the early stage, after receiving the early stage capital, you can prove genuinely that this business is different, this innovation is different, and this has a potential to capture a large market, then they will probably give you the expansion capital. And after expanding, still you may need capital for further expansion, and then you can get what is called the late stage capital. You must keep in mind that all this capital are not given by the single venture capitalist. It is possible that some venture capitalist will give you the seed capital and startup capital, and when you are in the early stage of capital, that venture capitalist might lose appetite for giving further capital, and they may introduce another venture capitalist to give you the further funding. It may so happen that some of the venture capitalists who had given you early stage funding will exit their exposure to another venture capitalist, maybe a larger venture capitalist who can bring more capital. So they will reduce their exposure and they will bring in another new venture capital. It is possible that all through these five stages, the venture capitalist also, the list of venture capitalists financing you will also undergo a small or big change. Coming to the valuation of the business, there is something called pre-money determinants, which is basically the management team, market, and competitive advantage in the marketplace. These are the three items which are used to determine the pre-money valuation of the business. And then after the money is given, or the after all the money is given in various stages, there comes the post-money valuation. Post-money valuation very often will be linked to the public issue and to make your company really global. Venture capitalists have basically two interests. They have interest on the economics of the deal. That means they are giving money and they will get back the money, and they should understand that they are going to get it back, and they are going to get it back with a reasonable return. Normally they will look for a IRR of say 20, 25, 30%, that kind of IRR they are looking at. And if they invest money in an unlisted company, and if after 2, 3 or 4 years that unlisted company goes to listing, it is quite possible that that kind of money they will be able to make. So that is their first interest. The second interest is they want to have control on you. I mean, they should be very careful that whatever money you have got, you have not frittered it away, you have not misused it, or you have not siphoned it off from the company and things like that, which is quite likely. Sometimes there are mischievous entrepreneurs who basically float company to take out money from the company and make it into their private asset. They have no genuine interest of running a business in the long run. So the venture capitalist has to be very careful as to what kind of people they are financing. So that's why they will try to keep a control, they will try to keep a tab on what you are doing. They do it in various ways. They nominate a board member in the board of directors of the company, and they will put a veto clause. That means although that director will be a minority in the board of directors, suppose the board has 5 members and they have only 1 member from the venture capitalist, but that member will have a veto power. That means on certain matters which is listed in the agreement, even that 1 member of the board who is nominated by the venture capitalist will be able to block a resolution, will be able to veto against a resolution so that that resolution does not go through. Suppose if he senses that you are trying to give contract to a related party, or you are trying to give contract at an exorbitant price to your friend or associate, he may come in the way and he may say, no, I don't agree with this, here is my veto. Once the veto is given, the board resolution cannot be passed, the contract cannot be given to a related party. I am just giving an example. Then they, as I already said, they will do stage-wise funding. They will not give you all the money that you require at one stage. They will give in the seed capital and the primary and the first stage of capital, second stage of capital, expansion capital, like that. They will go on enhancing the capital depending on your capital infusion, depending on your performance. Then they sometimes provide loan as a sweetener. When a loan is given over and above the equity contribution, as per law in most of the countries, you are called upon to pledge your assets against the loan. So they will give you some loan and they will take pledge on your asset. The pledge on the asset takes as a dual control. On the one side, they will control on you through the nominee member of the board of directors through the veto right. On the other side, they will have pledge on the asset so that you cannot liquidate the asset for any purpose which is not commensurate with the long-term business of the company. And they have what is called tag-along and drag-along rights. These are the very two important rights that they have, and without a tag-along and drag-along right, normally no venture capital will give you money. We need to know very clearly what is a tag-along right and what is a drag-along right. Suppose you 3 or 4 of your friends have started a company, it has taken venture capital and it has recorded a reasonable growth, but now for some reason you want to sell this company to a larger company and make your money and leave the company. If the venture capitalist sense about it, and if the venture capitalist feel that this could be a good idea, then venture capitalist will enforce what is called a tag along right. That means he will say, if you sell your share at X profit or X percentage of profit, I should also sell my share at X percentage of profit. Whoever is taking over your company, he has to not only buy your shares, he has to buy the share of the venture capitalist also if he so desires. Or in other words, the venture capitalist does not want to carry the baby left out, carry the baby sacrificed by you. Venture capitalist will also be a part of it, he will also realize some money and let then it go to another promoter or another venture capitalist, they have no issue. So that is what is called a tag along right. Similarly, there could be a drag along right. It can so happen that you or your company is not doing well and venture capitalists are not very happy with your performance. They have also investment in same or similar businesses, maybe larger businesses which are more ready for better growth or which are more ready for public issue. In that event, they can sell, okay, I sell my shares to this new company or I contribute my shares to this merger and you also should sell your shares. They will drag you along, they will force you to sell your shares to the designated party which they have decided. In both cases, they will make some money, you will make some money, but you will no longer be in control of the company. So these are the two major rights that they want to enforce as a venture capitalist. Then they put in a lock-in period. That means they tell that for so many years you cannot sell your share capital, or for so many years you cannot resign from the management of the company, because you are the promoter, you are the innovator, and if you leave it for a grander pasture or for a better place, then the company will be left high and dry. So they do not want that. That is why they will put in a lock-in period. You cannot sell your shares for so many years and you cannot leave the management for so many years. Then there would always be a key man clause. Suppose the main innovator who has lot of experience and who is basically the brain behind the venture, he cannot allow that person to leave. So they will put a key man clause over there, but this key man cannot leave the company. And this key man or these two key men, for example, if there are more than one, cannot leave the company. That kind of clause they can put. And they can also put an anti-dilution clause. That means suppose you are holding 40% of the company, venture capitalist is holding 60% of the company, you cannot dilute your shares. You cannot say make it 40-20, whereas venture capitalists are still holding such large of capital in the company. Or in other words, you cannot sell your shares at your sweet will. Either you will be a falling trap to a tag along right or falling trap to a drag along right. Unless both are there or any of them are there, it will be very, very difficult for you to sell your holding in the company until, of course, your company is listed. Once the company is listed, as you know, the share capital will be much larger. And then probably you will have some window to sell your shares in the market and exit if you so want. But by and large, if your venture is successful, it has come up to the stage of a public issue, you have given reasonable return to your venture capitalist, normally you will not like to leave the company or sell the company to a third party. Now, how the venture capitalist will exit? Because a venture capitalist has put money into the company not to run your company. They just try to handle the company. They just try to see the company successful so that their money grows. But after growing of the money, at some stage they have to take out the money and put it in some other growing venture, some other innovative venture, because that is their job. They just want extraordinary return on the money, and then they find out some other company and try to put money over there. So they have to have an exit. They do not want to own the company perpetually. So what are the methods through which they can exit? One is the most important is, of course, the IPO, initial public offering, which as I told you, they normally make investment in a unlisted company and then they see it through and take it up to a initial public offering, and when initial public offering takes place, they sell fully or partly their shares. By the process of selling, they would make a lot of money. So recently Bandhan Bank is coming into public issue. Those investors who had purchased privately the Bandhan Bank shares, they will make a lot of money. They can sell through merger or acquisition. Suppose you have, normally the venture capitalists make investment in two or three companies, probably in the same business. All of them do not have the same run. Some have run very sound, some have been very profitable, some are not so profitable, some are even loss making. So they have one option, they can force, because they have the drag along and drag along right. So through the drag along right, they can force the loss making company to merge into a profit making company, so that the overall return of their investment is protected. They can also, in reasonable cases where they find it so, they can go for recapitalization, they can buy back the shares of the owners. If they think that this owner is not good, but the business as a whole is good, then they can tell the owner, okay, you sell your shares to us and we will find a new promoter who will be able to run this business better, possible. And sometimes they also provide some debt. As I told you, debt is mainly given to keep a control on the assets of the company. And they can convert the equity into debt in some cases, and to that extent also they can make an exit. So these are the various routes through which venture capitalists can make an exit. I think this is all what I had to discuss about venture capital.